years back after what I hope for you has been a good summer break. Certainly it's been a good summer musically, I think. And on the eve now, really, of our fifth series of Whistle Test programmes, this particular programme is by way of a prologue to that series. And we're going to have a look back at perhaps one of the most successful programmes we've ever done, certainly the one that we've had most requests to see again. In February this year, Mike Appleton and myself went over to New York to record an interview with John Lennon. Some music was attached to that too, and that's going to take up the whole of tonight's programme. So let's join John Lennon in New York for our John Lennon Whistle Test special.
John, let's talk about New York first
of all. Bob.
Okay, because you've been here a good long time now and had a good chance to sort of digest the city.
Yeah. I mean,
how do you feel about New York as a city? Do you enjoy it here?
I still love it, yeah. I've been here three and a half or 4 years, something like that. Probably three and a half. The thing I like best about it is, A, it's 24 hours. And, you know, people are always saying, what's an American? You know? Well, people aren't always saying it. Actually, I'm saying it. But there's no such thing in a place like New York. And you know, I don't know about the Midwest and all that, those kind of places. That's what, you know, is America, I suppose. But in New York, it's a bit like London, only more so.
Mm-hmm.
Like, meaning everybody's a foreigner, you know. Nobody can speak, there's no set language. You know, you get in a cab and you say, I want to go to West 44th Street, and they say, what do you say, you know? So it's like, it's that bit I like. There's all the different nationalities here. And sometimes in the summer, it's like being in Calcutta or something. You can cut the heat with a knife, right? And you're always hearing congas going on in the park all the time. And it's like a festival going on. And I just dig it.
How different is life in New York, say, by comparison with life in London? Because, I mean, I don't know New York very well at all, but first impression I get, I mean, from, say, a 34th-story window, I mean, the city looks amazing, but it feels very tense down on the street.
Well, I don't know. To me, it's no tenser than Liverpool or London was. I mean, on the street in Liverpool, unless you're in the suburbs, yeah, I mean, you had to walk close to the wall, you know? And to get to the cavern, you know, for those of you who remember all that, it was no easy matter, even at lunchtime sometimes. You know, I mean, it's a tense place, you know? And Glasgow, Newcastle, London had it. When I first got to London, it was pretty nerve-wracking. We were all putting on, we're from Liverpool and we're a tough bit. But there were some hard knocks down in London, you know? And I think that's what you feel. It's almost the difference between Liverpool and London, London and New York. And it has that tenseness, but it's just that it's going at a tremendous speed, you know. I don't know why, but it is, you know. Mm. So people are that kind of tenseness, you know.
Mm. What about the music business in New York, John? I mean, say, for example, places to play, because there seems so much more activity here in that respect as well.
Yeah, well, the whole music business was here. A lot of it's moved to the West Coast, you know, like, because a lot of people like to go and lie out there, you know. So a lot of the industry's gone down there. But there's still plenty of studios, you know, and musicians. There's almost cliques, which I'm not keen on. That's why I like to use, you know, a few different people from different areas. But there's a lot of action here, a lot of good musicians. And, of course, all the English musicians pass through here and they cut tracks or they goof around, you know. So there's always input coming in, you know. And I generally stick to the same studio because, you know, I'm like that with doctors and dentists, you know, find one, stick with it.
Yeah. How many studios are there in town?
I have no idea. There must be a good 50 or 60. There's places out, somebody was telling me about out in Jersey, where they cut Shame, Shame, Shame. They've got a great scene going there, which I haven't visited, because that's like going to the sticks, you know, or something, although it's only around the corner. And they have these men that just clock in, do tracks, you know, and then they bring a singer in and put them on if the track's any good. So there's a lot of that kind of thing going on.
I get the impression, really, too, that there's a much greater kind of general awareness of rock music in this country. I mean, I saw on the television yesterday that there was a news item on Jethro Tull and their gig at Madison Square Gardens the other night. I mean, is there a greater awareness of rock music over here?
Well, then, I mean, they are. Profit isn't too dirty a word here, you know, as they say. And Madison Square is the place, you know. I mean, when anybody tours America or comes from England, wherever they come from, they have to hit Madison Square Garden and the place in L.A., which I can't remember. You know, I mean, that's the ones that count. The rest is just travel. And it's a big event, you know. And the local newsmakers, there's four or five channels of news. I mean, there's three big ones, and there's a couple thrown in of local stations, and then there's the sort of the BBC one, I call it, the WNET, they all have this, so there's eight news and they're all looking for something to say, you know? Mm. So they always cover the big events, especially Madison Square, whether it's Muhammad Ali or Jethro Tull. You know?
Mm.
And it's a big event, you know. And the industry is a multi-billion dollar industry. So it's I think it's bigger than the film industry now. And I think they're getting aware of that.
Mm. I was aware of that too in LA, really, because the emphasis seems to have shifted completely now from the movies to rock and roll. It seems to have become a rock and roll city, LA.
Yeah,
is that true?
Oh, the rock and rolls have taken over that city. Yeah. Mm. LA is now, you know, just rock and roll town, you know. And the movies are like a side issue almost. The movie people still live there, a lot of them, you know, the old time stars and that. But even the new movie stars, they hang out with rock and roll people. Rock and roll people are the new stars, you know. Mm. It's great.
There seems also, John, to be a really big difference now between the American singles and album charts and the charts in Britain.
That's what I'm finding out to my detriment.
Yes.
So, what I did was, I had a person at my office keep sending me the top 10 from England, because I have to find out what's going on, don't I? But, I mean, if I'm fighting IF by Telly Savalas, well, I've got a long battle.
What did you think, though, to the stuff that you heard? I mean, the local stuff from Britain.
I like it, because it sounds like rock and roll, you see. I only heard the first batch I got, I thought, I better check out what's going on over there. I had a feeling this rock and roll album would do better than my own stuff. When, after I'd heard, I had the first top 10 sent over and I listened to it, it was over Christmas. There was a lot of sort of imitation Elvis and and roll stuff. I thought, aha, oh, that's what it is, you know. Mm. It really is changing, you know.
Mm. Are you missing England very much, John?
Yeah, I try not to, you know, like I had, you know, your friend here bring me the chocolate Olivers. It's little things, you know, you miss, like black pudding, you know, and the chocolate Olivers. And I don't allow myself to miss it that much, because then I couldn't carry on fighting about my green card. I'm going to win that one first. And then, I keep telling myself, it'll be there. It'll take another 18 months to get the card, maybe 2 years. It's going to be there. Ain't going nowhere, you know.
Just to sort of clarify the situation, now, the reason that you've not come back is because if you leave America, you can't get back in here again.
Yeah, nobody said that nobody wrote a piece of paper. I mean, apart from every now and then they say, you've got 30 days to leave. I know that if I went, they wouldn't let me back in. I'd have a hell of a job getting back in. I mean, I was having a hell of a job coming in and out as it was. So does Paul, so does Mick, so does George. Mm. I mean, all the time when they want to come in here, they have to get on their knees 6 months in advance. And I got sick of that, you know. So I wanted to stay.
Mm.
And that's it, isn't it?
Mm.
Was that the answer?
More or less, yeah.
Yeah.
What is the green card situation?
The green card, the situation is I'm still appealing. Like every now and then they'll say, you've got 30 days to get out, and then my lawyer will appeal and we'll go up to another court or something like that, and it'll just go on forever. Terry Southern put it well. He says, it keeps the Conservatives happy that they're doing something about me and what I represent, and it keeps the Liberals happy because I haven't actually been thrown out, so everybody's happy, you know?
Yeah. Are you aware that there's a kind of specific... I don't know. Do you think that they are kind of picking on you, John?
Oh, yeah, they picked on me. I'm telling you, when it first started, I was followed in a car, and my phone was tapped. Now, we lost the phone tapping case because how do you prove your phone was tapped? Mm. Now, at that time, it was pre-Watergate, so you can imagine John Lennon says his phone's tapped and there's men following in a car. And but I went on a TV show here, a talk show at night, and said this was happening to me, and it stopped the next day. And I think they wanted me to know, to scare me, and I was scared, paranoid, you know.
Mm.
And people thought I was crazy then, you know. I mean, they do anyway, but, I mean, more so, you know, Lennon. Oh, you big-headed maniac, right? Who's going to follow you around? Well, what do they want? You know, that's what I'm saying. What do they want? You know, I'm not going to cause them any problem.
Yeah, yeah. Because you seem really, at the moment, John, to be kind of emerging now from what... from a distance anyway, seemed to be a kind of trough of depression.
Yeah, well, once you've been down, rather mentally, I mean, I go into these troughs every few years. It was less noticeable in the Beatles because the Beatles' image and thing would carry you through it, you know. I mean, I was in the middle of a trough in Help, you know, but you can't see it really. I mean, I'm singing Help for a kickoff, you know, but it was less noticeable because you're protected by the image of the power of the Beatles. Now when it happens, I'm on my own, right, you know. And it's easier to get sniped. And so I've been in a trough, so I'm out of it. I'm coming out of it. Whoopee, you know. I'll be around for the rest of my life in this business, so I don't get too serious about it. I only worry about what's happening to me.
Did you find that all the problems, John, were affecting your work during the last couple of years?
Yeah. I tried to pretend to myself that I wasn't being affected by it. It was just going off my back like water or whatever that thing is. But when I really got down to it, and I got down to it, I realized that it was a constant thing all the time, you know, just non-stop, you know, it was like a sort of big toothache, you know, it didn't go away. And it's still around now, but I think I've come to terms with it a bit. And it was just, you know, interfering with everything, you know. Like at one time I had this group together, Elephant's Memory and a few extra people, and I was ready to go on the road just for fun, you know. I didn't care whether I was going to get paid even, I just felt like going out, you know. And they started taking me to court, and I was sort of getting into the court scene, you know, I can get into any play, right? So I was getting the suits on, and I was talking to the judges, and there's TV, and it's a stage, you know, so I got more involved in that stage. I had to send them away, you know, and that put me off performing for a bit. And then I still sort of did my work, you know, because I can't stop it even if I'm in a bad state of mind. But it was affecting me. It affected my whole life, actually.
Because we read a lot, and I know for sure that the reports are terribly exaggerated about the thing at the Troubadour.
Oh, yeah.
John.
Yeah.
What did actually happen?
I got drunk and shouted, you know. It was the first night I drank Brandy Alexander's, which is brandy and milk, folks. And I was with Harry Nilsson, who didn't quite get as much coverage as me, the bum. And he really encouraged me, you know. There was, I usually have somebody there that says, okay, Lennon, shut up, and I take it, you know. But I didn't have anybody around me to say shut up, and I just went on and on. But there was some girl that claimed I hit her, which I didn't hit her at all, you know. She just wanted some money. I had to pay her off, you know, because I thought it'll harm immigration. And she said she was a press photographer, but she had an Instamatic, you know. And I couldn't, you know, she didn't even have any pictures. I was saying, well, if I hit her, why isn't the pictures of me, you know, like that? And they just sort of said, oh, okay, you better leave, Mr. Lennon. They took me out. So I was drunk. When it's Errol Flynn, you know, all them showbiz writers say, those were the days when we had Sinatra and Errol Flynn socking it to the people, you know, the real men. I do it, and I'm a bum. So it was a mistake, but hell, you know, well, I'm human, you know. I was drunk in Liverpool and smashed phone boxes, huh? It didn't get in the papers then. But I didn't hit the reporter, but she got $1,000 or some crap, you know, because I had to pay her off, which is what it was. She wasn't a reporter, in fact.
Mm. You did spend quite a lot of time in L.A. last year, didn't you?
Yeah, yeah, I was sort of, you know, avoiding reality. Yeah.
Did you enjoy Harry Nilsson's album? Did you enjoy doing it?
Well, enjoy isn't the word. You see, what happened was he lost his voice. And I don't know whether it was psychological or what, but we did one session and then that was it, you know. And he was going to doctors and being injected, and he didn't tell me till later that he was bleeding in the throat, or I would have stopped the sessions, you know. But he had no voice, and what do you do, you know? I'm saying, well, where's all that stuff, you know? And he's gone, and some of the writers thought he was imitating me. He wasn't imitating me. He had no voice, but we were committed. The main fun was, we had a lot of fun. There was Keith Moon, Harry, me, Ringo, all living together in the house, and we had some moments, folks, but it got a little near the knuckle. That's when I straightened out in the middle of that album. That's when I realized, there's something wrong here. You know, this is crazy, man. So then I suddenly was the straight one in the middle of all these mad, mad people. I suddenly was not one of them, you know. Mm. And I pulled myself back and finished off the album best I could, you know. But it's just a shame that he... You know, what do you do? I mean, you know, we'd already spent the money. Everybody was booked in. We had tapes. And so me and Harry probably had the best out of it, you know, because we had spent a few good nights together.
Because we talked about the pace of New York, John, yeah. But really L.A.'s got its own rhythm, hasn't it?
Yeah, well, what happens is in L.A., it tends to be what clique you hang out in, you know. So obviously when I get down there, I'm in with mainly the musicians. You touch the fringes of the movies and the other scenes, you know, they sort of intermingle. But, you know, LA is a lot big rock show down there, you know, and so it's mainly a lot of musicians, you know, we're all jamming around in different sessions, and it's all that scene, you know. Mm. So that has its pace, but it's a little manana when you come out, you know. Like, can we get so-and-so, you know. Hey, what's your sign, baby?
How did the involvement with David Bowie come about?
Well, he sort of seems to be in New York, right? And I seem to be the guy in New York that all the Englishmen say hi to, you know. And which is good, you know, if Mick's in town, Paul's in town, anybody comes, I love it, you know. All the rockers come and say, hey, what's happening, you know. And I'm supposed to show them what's happening. Or they already know, most of them, anyway. And I got to know David through Mick, really, although I'd met him once before. And next minute he says, hello, John, I'm doing Cross the Universe. Do you want to come on down? So I said, all right, you know, I live here. I popped down and I played rhythm. And then he had this lick, you know, we'd finished Across the Universe and he had, this guitarist had a lick, so we sort of wrote this song, you know, it was no big deal. We just sort of, boom, 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 you know, like that. It wasn't like sitting down to write a song, so we made this lick into a song is what happened. And that's how it happened, and there it is, you know. Mm. And people are all saying, well, what's he doing with Elton John and David Bowie? I'm doing it because it's fun, you know. Mm-hmm. He used to do it, like we used to have Brian Jones on You Know My Name, a Beatle number. He's playing on that, playing sax, you know. But in those days, you couldn't tell. You weren't supposed to tell. So we'd have a lot of people on our sessions, the Beatles sessions, and nobody would know who was on because we weren't allowed to tell. Then it went through the phase where you said, you know, Johnny O'Len is playing guitar, or George O'Harris, or George has some name. He's played on everybody's records. But now you just put your name on it, you know, as long as the company knows. Mm. And it's cool, you know, especially if you're doing nothing.
Yeah, because you seem to have really enjoyed the things you did with Elton.
Oh, yeah. Well, Elton and I are very close, you know. David, I know him quite well, but I don't know him as well as Elton. It was just, you know, what do you say? I'm doing your song, you want to come? All right, I'll come.
Did the live thing that you did with Elton prompt you to start thinking about going on the road again?
No, well, my quote was, when I came off, I enjoyed it a lot, but I wouldn't like to do it for a living. You know, I mean, if I can live without doing it, I'll do it. If I get the urge to perform, you know, I'll do it. And if I do a tour ever, I'll wait for my green card and I'll do a tour of the world, you know. I don't just going around in circles, but, you know, I may as well do it all. But I always was a record man, you know. I mean, I like the studio always best once I got the hang of it and the control of it. I like it because it's complete control. And even as a fan when I was younger, I wasn't that mad on seeing the artist live. I like the record, you know. I like the record of Bebopalula, say. I'm not particularly mad on seeing Gene Vincent every time he came to town. You know, I wasn't that upset that Elvis never came to England. I'll go for the records, the pre-army records, you know. So records is what I was hooked on. Mm. You know, if they came around, I might go see, you know.
The inevitable question.
I mean, are they ever going to get back together?
Yeah, I mean, first of all, is there any possibility? But secondly, much more important, Do you think that it's a good idea?
Well, that's another point altogether, Whether it'd be a good idea or not. You see, it's strange, because at one period when they were asking me, I was saying, no, never, what the hell, go back, no, not me. And then there came to a period when I thought, well, why not, if we felt like making a record or doing something. Everybody always envisages the stage show. To me, if we were together at studio again, you know, the stage show is something else. If we've got something to say in a studio, okay. Now, when I'm saying that, I turn the paper and Georgie say, not me, right? It's never got to a position where each one of us have wanted to do it at the same time. I think over the period of being apart, we've all thought, oh, that wouldn't be nice. That wouldn't be bad, you know. I mean, I've worked with Ringo and George. I haven't worked with Paul because we had a more difficult time, but now we're pretty close, you know. So, and the other question is, would it be worth it? You know, but that is answered by if we wanted to do it. If we wanted to do it, then it'd be worth it. If we got in the studio together and thought we turn each other on again, then it would be worth it, you know. Mm. And sod the critics, you know. I mean, you know, they've got nothing to do with it. You know, the music is the music. If we make a piece that we think was worthwhile, it goes out. But it's such a, you know, it's pie in the sky, you know. Mm. I don't care either way, you know. If somebody wants to pull it together, I'll go along, you know. I'm not in the mood to pull it together, that's for sure. I've got too much, I think we all have got too much to do ourselves. But if they were all in town, I'd say, come on down, you know, put them on my record, right? Then it'd be a Beatle record. But if they were around, you know, I jammed with Paul. I did actually play with Paul, yeah. We did a lot of stuff in LA. But there was 50 other people playing too, and they're all just watching me and Paul, you know.
Yeah. You must be pleased with what Paul's doing now, John.
I'm pleased that everybody's doing well, you know. Yeah. I'm more pleased that Ringo's doing well, you know, that he's got himself a good niche. Because I knew Paul would be all right. What the hell? I'm worried about him. You know, I know he's going to be all right.
In retrospect now, do you regret How Do You Sleep?
No, somebody said the other day, it's about me. You know, I regret that it was so... Not the song is... two things I regretted. One, that there was so much talk about Paul. They missed the song. It was a good track. And I should have, you know, kept my mouth shut, not on the song. It could have been about anybody, you know. I mean, and when you look at them back, you know, Dylan said it about his stuff, that he found out most of it's about him. I wrote a sort of Son of How Do You Sleep on Walls and Bridges, I can't remember the name, Steel and Glass, which I thought was about a few people, but then I'm realizing, no, it's me again. So it's not about Paul, it's about me, you know, I'm really attacking myself. But I regret the association, but what a regret, you know, I mean, he lived through it. The only thing that matters is how he and I feel about those things, and not what about, you know, the writer or the commentator thinks about it. You know, him and me are okay, so I don't care what they say about that. You know, I can go through my thing. I've always been a little different. You know, Lennon blasts Hollies. You know, that was one of the early steps. I mean, I've always been that. Our first national press was me beating up a disc jockey at Paul's 21st party. That was the first Beatles national press, and we got the back page of the Mirror. I've always been a little, you know, loose. And I hope it'll change, because I'm fed up of waking up in the papers, you know. But if it doesn't, you know, my friends are my friends, whatever way.
Let's talk about the new album, John, because really the recording of the new album spanned
many eons. Well, the rock and roll album, folks, started in 73 after I'd finished Mind Games, and I was really in the middle of that, oh, you know, what's going on, mother, life, help. And I'd just done Mind Games, and I was taught, you know, how can I have some fun instead of all this writing my feelings and these songs, you know, being the writer and the artist, you know. I thought, what can I do to, you know, break that regime of, you know, writing the song John Lennon writes, new song, is it about him or is it about Paul or, you know, whatever. So I thought, I know. I'm always in between takes and with the Beatles too. I always would break into Bebopalula or we'd always jam those songs, you know. They're my favorite songs, a lot of them. And I never did them because I admired the original so much I wouldn't dare touch them. But by now people are ruining everything, so I thought, why can't I do it? You know, they're all doing it, so what the hell, you know. So I thought, I know, who shall I use, you know? The great Phil Spector, you know. I'd used him before, but I'd always controlled it and been co-producer. But this one, it took me 3 weeks to talk him into being the producer. I said, look, I'm Ronnie on this one, all right? I just want to sing. I don't want to know nothing about nothing. So we started the sessions, and they went well, and then they gradually collapsed into mania, you know. It's one way of putting it. But it definitely got crazy, you know. There was 28 guys playing a night, and 15 of them were out of their minds, including me. And the sessions broke down. We broke them down pretty well, me and Phil. They got really balmy, you know. I'm not even going to say what happened. Some of it was ridiculous. And that's the first time I ever let an album out of my control since the first Beatle albums. I never do it again. And next minute, I didn't have the tapes, and Phil had a car accident. That's all I heard. I waited 8 months in L.A. waiting for him to recover.
Where was he at that point, John?
He's a mysterious man. His woodwork to perform, my dear. Phil works in such mysterious ways, his woodwork to perform. He's a great artist, but like all artists, it's, you know, anyway, all I knew, I was sitting around in L.A. waiting for the tape to finish the album, right? So I got fit, and that's how I ended up doing Harry. I was just hanging out with you know, guys, and all we were doing was getting drunk and, you know, waking up, you know, sick. So that's why I said to Harry, let's forget this, let's do something, you know. So then after that, I came home to New York, and by then, I'd straightened myself out, and I was ready to do Walls and Bridges, and I was straight and, you know, no drink, right? And I thought, okay, I'm ready to record. The day before I go in to record, I get the tapes back. We finally made a deal. It had to do with deals, as usual. I get the Phil Spector tapes back. There's about 8 tracks. Half of them that you couldn't use, you know, for one reason or another. Like, if you've got 10 people playing out of tune, and the other, you know, I mean, like, that Angel Baby is a phenomenal track. You know, so I sorted out the best of the Spector stuff, what I thought was the best, and decided the best way to finish it was to just go in and finish it. So I did the rest of it by myself, using the basic unit that I usually use, about 8 guys, and I did it in about 5 days, you know, 3 tracks a night, you know. I just said rock and roll, okay, rock, and we just went in. I rehearsed them a couple of days beforehand, so they were loose. Then we just went in and did, like, take 1 Stand By Me, take 2 Bebopalula, you know, the opposite of what was going on down the West Coast. And this was a year later. I did that after Walls and Bridges. I took about a couple of weeks off, and then it was a choice of either just leaving it forever and never putting it out, or trying to find some format for 4 or 5 Spector tracks, which I didn't think were singles. You know, they might be, I couldn't tell, you know. I was so sick of the whole thing. So I thought, now what do I do? Just leave it in the can. I hate leaving stuff in the can. I've got no stuff in the can, neither of the Beatles. And I thought, okay, finish it off and see what it is, you know. So I finished it off and I played it round to a few people that weren't me. And they said, I played it to the record company. I didn't know what to do with it. I said, yeah, I don't know whether to release it even. You know, I've got it off my chest, I've finished it. And they all said, this is all right. It's all right, let's put it out. I said, it's all right, is it? Okay, we'll put it out. And then once it went out, I thought, great, it's out, you know. It's out after, because I've never been so long on an album in my life. It was longer than Sgt. Pepper, you know. I normally take 8 weeks to make an album from start to finish out in the shops, you know, otherwise I get bored. And this has been going on and on. Oh, click.
Yeah, you touched on Sgt. Pepper, John, and...
Oh, did I? Yeah, yes, that was 9 months off and on, you know.
Yeah.
And, but that, it wasn't like 9 months in the studio, it was 9 months over a period, and we'd do a section and then stop and then come back in, if I can remember it right. And I like to just get in and out, you know, I get a bit bored.
What's Sgt. Pepper done on an 8-track?
They keep telling me that. It's 4 or 8, it must have been 8, it wasn't 16, I never saw a 16 in EMI, I don't think. If I've got you wrong, I'm sorry. But I don't think, it was always the 16 was coming, you know. Mm. And I don't know, 4 or 8, I'm not sure.
Mm. How did you do it then?
I have no idea, I can't remember it. You know, I remember something about an orchestra and we were all dressed up, that's the only bit I remember. I remember being, you know, my memory is different, right? I remember singing Day in the Life on a guitar and Mal shouting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 for the breaks, and that's, it's really like that, and taking the picture on the album.
Yeah.
And if you look closely at the album cover, you'll see two people who are flying and two who aren't. That's just a little in-joke. Two of them didn't share it with two others.
Again, John, something really that's always fascinated me is the working relationship between yourself and George Martin, because you were talking earlier about wanting to be in control of things. And I get the feeling, really, that in terms of the working relationship, and you must tell me whether this is right or not, between you and George Martin worked in the sense that he was the technical advisor, and in a sense the creative input, the musical input, came from the band. I mean, is that true?
Yeah, it's hard to describe a relationship. You know, they either say George did, Martin did everything, or the Beatles did everything. It was neither one, you know. We both, George had done little of no rock and roll when we met him, and we'd never been in a studio, so we did a lot of learning together. He had a very great musical knowledge and background, so he could translate for us and suggest a lot of things, which he did, you know, and he'd come up with amazing technical things like slowing down the piano and playing it slow and putting it on and things like that, you know, where we'd be saying, well, can we want to go and he'd say, well, look, chaps, I thought of this afternoon. Last night I was talking to whoever he was talking, and I came up with this, you know, and we said, oh, great, great, we'll put it on here, you know. And like in Walrus, when we made it, we had, on the mix of Walrus, we have a live radio coming through, you know. So whatever came through on the radio was like, now, if I just, I don't know where it came from, if I said, I want the radio on it, George would make it so that I could mix, and there, well, the radio would be coming through the machines, you know. But he also come up with things like, well, have you heard an oboe? Oh, which one's that? Is this one? Hey, that would be nice. Mm. You know, things like that. So it was really, we grew together, you know? Mm. And so it's like saying, it's hard to say who did what, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, he taught us a lot, and I'm sure we taught him a lot by our sort of primitive musical ability, which is all I have still, you know? I still have to have something to translate what I'm trying to say all the time. And so it was a mutual benefit, society, whatever they call it.
And you just now, John, started putting together ideas for the new album.
Yeah, I've got 3/4 of the new album on scraps of paper, which is usual. And now I'm going through the bit of going over them and sort of half arranging them before I go in the studio. I'm also in the process of putting a TV show together that will be round the album and round other music.
What, a one-off? You mean?
Yeah. I don't want to be Coronation Street. Just want one show, you know. And so I'm sort of coordinating that with the album. So I'm really, so it's in my head, you know. I just have to put it on paper now.
Mm. Presumably, when the green card comes through, I mean, you will see you in England.
Oh, you bet. Of course, yeah. I've got family in England. You know, yeah. I've got a child who has to keep travelling. Oh, hello, Julian. Got it in already. I've got my auntie Mimi. Hello, Mimi, and all my other relatives. Were furious at me, but we won't say why. But anyway, Mimi isn't.
Oh, let's stop there, John.
Yeah.
Thanks very much indeed.
That's it's a pleasure.
Really pleasure to meet you.
And you. Hello, England. Keep sending those chocolate Olivers. Keep your chin up. We'll meet again. I don't know where, don't know when. The White Cliffs of Dover.